Poker Satellite Strategy by Dara O'Kearney and Barry Carter, narrated by Dara O'Kearney. How to get the most out of this book. We deliberated for a long time whether to produce an audio version of this book because, like a lot of poker books, there was a significant visual component to it. In Poker Satellite Strategy, we include a lot of tables that show hand ranges, which would frankly sound bizarre and be impossible to follow if you're simply listening to it. However, enough people asked for an audiobook and the visual element is mostly located in the sizable chapter we have on shoves, so we've made some adjustments in order to make this book audio friendly. While you may benefit from getting a print or ebook version of this book to accompany the audiobook, we have produced a free handout with visual reference materials so you can follow along without having to buy a second copy. You can get that handout, which you will need for chapter 4 and chapter 5, by visiting foldaces.com. This also includes the entirety of chapter 13 in text, which we simply would not have been able to reproduce in audio. To get the most out of this book, we have made some assumptions about how familiar you are with some of the key concepts of poker. If you are unfamiliar in any way with the following assumptions, it is perhaps best to do a bit of independent research to bring you up to speed. The first assumption is that you know how to play poker and understand basic terminology like big blind, flop, three bet, and shove. If you do not currently know how to play poker, you would be much better off spending your time Googling how to play the game and using some of the many free resources available online before studying satellite-specific strategy. We also assume that you have a basic understanding of how multi-table tournaments work. You will have played quite a few of them. You understand the prize structures. You know how the strategy changes at different stages of the tournament and generally appreciate how they are different to cash games. We are heading into very obvious territory now, but you should also know what a satellite tournament is. We will cover in depth the differences in approach between regular tournaments and satellites, but you will already be aware that in a satellite, all the prizes are of equal value rather than increasing prizes with every bust out. This is what makes them distinct from other tournament formats, and particularly makes the bubble stage, the final position before the surviving players make the money, profoundly important. You should also have a small understanding of the concept of independent chip model, or ICM. This is a calculation used to understand the current real money value of your chip stack during different stages of a tournament. You don't need to be an expert in this at all, because we will be exploring it in some detail, but it would perhaps serve you well to do another quick Google search before you start reading, so you at least know what we are referring to. You should have an understanding of the concept of equity as it relates to a poker hand. For example, it is well documented that most pocket pairs are close to 50-50 against two overcards, so they usually have an equity of around 50%. Pocket aces is a favorite against most hands and has more than 80% equity against most ranges. There are a lot of free poker equity calculators available online and for a smartphone. So if this is a new concept to you, please download one of them and play around with it before you get to the endgame chapters. The examples in this book will not be about how to play a specific hand in a specific spot, but instead we'll look at different situations and then determine what range of hands you would need to call, shove, or fold. As a poker player, you should always be thinking in terms of your range anyway, but because in super satellites the biggest decisions you make are pre-flop, it is particularly important to think about all the hands you would want to play in each scenario. When we look at whether to call an all-in, we will not be looking at it from the perspective of ace-king or pocket jacks, but the full selection of hands that would make a profitable call, and by inference, the full range of hands we wouldn't call with. With that in mind, when we talk about a range of hands for brevity, we start with the weakest part of that range that qualifies. So when we say that your calling range is ace-jack suited plus, ace-10 off plus, king-queen suited, pocket eights plus, ace-4 off to ace-3 off, that means ace-jack, ace-queen, and ace-king suited. Ace-10, ace-jack, ace-queen, and ace-king offsuit. Ace-4 and ace-3 offsuit. King-queen suited. Pocket-8s, pocket-9s, pocket-10s, pocket-jacks, pocket-queens, pocket-kings, pocket-aces are all part of that range. Throughout this book, when we present the range of hands you should be shoving and calling with, we will begin with ranges that are game theory optimal, or GTO. This means we are making the assumption that everyone at the table is playing perfectly and calling and shoving with the right ranges. We use GTO as a baseline because it is harder to exploit, especially in tough games, and also because when you don't know how your opponents typically play, it is your best default strategy. In reality, nobody plays perfectly, and as the book develops, we are going to show you how to adjust from GTO ranges when you have a read on a player which you can exploit. For example, if they fold more hands than would be optimal. Don't get married to the GTO ranges, just use them as a foundation to diverge from when you learn more about your opponents. We have a general assumption that you are a serious amateur player rather than a professional. The advice in this book is aimed at both amateurs and professionals alike. In fact, some of it we consider very advanced, but it is written mostly with amateurs in mind to make it accessible to both parties. We have ordered the content in this book in terms of importance for your own satellite game. We start with some quick tweaks you can make right away. Then we cover the bubble stage of satellites in depth afterwards, because that is the most important stage. Then we explore further topics in order of their relevance. So while it may not be structured as you would expect a poker book to be, we think you will see the benefits sooner in your game. Finally, we want to make it clear that this book will be covering super satellites, where more than one prize of equal value will be won. These are by far the most common form of satellite, and the format we believe merits a strategy book of their own. We will not be covering winner-takes-all satellites with a single prize on offer, because the approach used for them is that of a chip EV strategy where cash game advice would be more appropriate. With the obvious out of the way, let's dive in. Chapter 2, Satellites in 30 Minutes. To get the most out of this book, we want to give you the foundations to review your own play away from the tables, so you develop a solid understanding of satellite endgame and ICM when you are at the tables. We want the common scenarios to have come up so frequently in your self-study that when they present themselves at the table, you automatically know what your shoving, folding, and calling ranges will be. We know this process will take some time. You're not expected to read a book in one sitting. In fact, you probably should be making notes and returning several times to important sections. Nor are you expected to not play poker before you complete the book. We also appreciate that you may be reading this book for the first time, literally on your way to play in a satellite, or are sat reading it at the table right now. To begin with, we want to fix the biggest leaks in your satellite game right away, so you can see the important concepts working in practice before you get deep into the theory. If you are already a competent player, following our simple rules below could make you a small winner in satellites. The bubble is all or nothing. The bubble of a poker tournament is the point where one player is left to bust out before everyone makes the money. You either end the tournament inside the money bubble or outside of it. This is significant in a regular tournament, but in a satellite when the bubble is over, the tournament ends. Busting out of a regular tournament on the bubble stings, but if you are playing for the win, then it's easy to recover from. Making a mistake on the bubble of satellite is so much more costly because there is only one prize you can win and it is usually much bigger than a regular MTT min cash. We will elaborate on this as you read on, but always keep in mind that the nearer you are to the bubble, the more mistakes are magnified. The philosophy of satellites. A non-poker friend once asked me why I seem to be a much better player in super satellites than real tournaments. It seemed pointless to even bring up ICM, so to put it in layman terms, I said that if normal tournaments were war, then satellites were more like the Cold War. Later on in a satellite, you need to display to your opponents that you are willing to engage while doing everything possible to avoid actual confrontations. Merely understanding that gives you an advantage over opponents who have never heard of mutually assured destruction. This viewpoint should point you towards your own biggest leaks when it comes to super satellites. Either you are playing like a maniac and playing too many hands, especially calling too much, or everybody knows you are willing to blind yourself out to make the money, so you will be seen as a soft target. Neither approach is ideal, so keep this in mind before anything else. You have to appear dangerous, so ideally you'll have been seen playing aggressively when you get the hands to do so. But you will want to avoid confrontations as much as possible. This runs contrary to regular MTTs, where you could say that the philosophy of them is to realize your equity by getting your strong hands paid as much as possible so you can build a big stack for the final table. Play tight and reduce variance. The fundamental difference between satellites and regular multi-table tournaments is that you are playing for prizes of equal value. That should be obvious, but it is important to repeat. You are playing for prizes of equal value. There is no difference between the Victor Blom wannabe who is raising every hand and has accumulated 60% of the chips in play and the tight player who sneaks over the line with three big blinds. When the tournament is over, they have both won a ticket to the same event. In reality, the difference between the two players is that the tight player is going to win more seats over the course of their satellite career. In a regular MTT, it pays to take risks because the name of the game is finishing as high as possible, where the big prizes are. ICM obviously does play a factor in MTTs, but taking calculated risks to build a big stack helps you get to the big money payouts. Calling a raise with a small pair in the hopes of making a set, chasing a draw because you think your opponent will pay you off,
or making a call with an inferior hand because you are priced in. These are all tactics which will see you bust early from MTTs, but when they pay off, they put you in a good position to secure a massive payday. Playing to mean cash is a terrible strategy long-term in MTTs, but in satellites, I mean cash is the goal. The number of times you cash is much more important than your ability to crush the field, so that means reducing the number of times you bust by not taking needless risks. You do have to build a stack to get you to the bubble, but you should look to adopt a tight, aggressive strategy and remove any high variance plays from your arsenal. That means once the blinds have started to get big, no set mining with small pairs, no chasing draws with suited connectors, no coin flips, and avoid defending with poor holdings because you are priced in. These moves may be chippy v correct, but they reduce your chances of having a survivable stack come bubble time. Once the blinds are big and the stack sizes become shallow, consider open shoving your strong hands to avoid being reshoved over, even if you have 20 or 30 effective big blinds. If you open to 2.5x...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.